Hello and welcome. Today is Wednesday, the 23rd of March, 2016. My name is Chris, this is the World Crypto Network, and I am back kind of officially. I did a little impromptu video last night in my insomnia phase, but this is really the first time that we've been back with the full node project since the South Africa trip back in Joburg about 3 weeks ago now. And I'm joined here today by an exciting lineup of people. For a start, I'd like to welcome Janine Corinna, who is producing this show and is going to start off by asking some questions as well. So, yeah, so this will be Janine's first time, like asking questions and stuff, and I'm just basically going to supervise. We're also joined by Shannon from Vettage. Hey, Shannon, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. Great to be here.
Great. Looking forward to learning about, you know, your project. I haven't seen too much of it yet, so this is going to be genuine, authentic excitement from me as I learn about it. But I know the gist of it, and I like it already. And we're also joined by a real stalwart and loyal supporter of the World Crypto Network, Mose, who's done so much work for hosting our shows on BitTorrent and now on IPFS as well. Hi, Mose. How are you doing?
Hi.
Coming in. Where are you coming in from?
From Zurich, Switzerland.
Nice one. Okay. And what I'm going to look forward to is hearing you talk about the stuff you're doing with IPFS. If you are curious, you can see the links to everybody in the show notes below. So Janine, hand over. Let's take it away with Vettage. I want to hear about this.
Yeah. So I wanted to do a follow-up to the video that we did previously about decentralized journalism, which was showing like the story I'd been working on with Apple versus FBI. And then I was contacted by Shannon, and he was asking some questions about how we would open source Vettage, how we could maybe incorporate things like Bitcoin and IPFS. I mentioned IPFS, and he sounded interested in that. And so then I decided it would be good to invite him onto the show to talk about Vettage, because I thought it was really interesting. It's a decentralized journalism project, so I just wanted to ask him a few questions about that so more people can know about it. So Shannon, can you first tell us a little bit about Vettage and what motivated you to start it?
Well, yeah, that's huge answers, but I'll try to frame it. Vettage was originally conceived and still is a decentralized journalism, multimedia, sort of collaborative multimedia software as a service. That was the original intent. To be, you know, not really a news organization, which, you know, and all the centralized aspects that come with that, but to open it up, you know, to allow more fairness, to afford, you know, news consumers a lot more accountability for, you know, sources and diversity. I got the idea. I was in college, which I recently went back and finished my degree at USC Franklin. And I was sitting in a class, it was Diversity and Ethics in Journalism, taught by a really great professor, Michael Bloom. And I think it was just the result of a lot of ideas that were circulating. And you know, my father was a journalist, a civil rights journalist. They went out to work for ABC News Nightline, and, you know, documentaries, and I grew up in New York City. And just a lot of these things that were, you know, in my mind at the time, all came together. And I just felt that, you know, the news industry as a whole historically is built and so integrated with advertising, or dependence on advertising. And I just, you know, and then Bitcoin emerged. And so there are a lot of these factors sort of, you know, in the soup, and Vettage really is what emerged. Just a really simple approach, a reinvention of the industry, you know, and kind of leveling the playing field, you know, and to get journalists paid. Another one of my professors, Dan Gilmore, he's advocating a new business model for journalism, which is kind of a mantra of journalism schools in America, creating new business models. Newman Journalism Lab is another subscription that I have that sends me articles pretty much every day, every week, that enforce that need for a new business model for journalism. So, I didn't really see another way of doing it without Bitcoin, a decentralized structure. So that was the original interest in it. It's grown ever since then. So, hoping it'll eventually, launch and be what it's intended to be.
Okay, cool. And so the second question I had is, what would distinguish, or what do you hope will distinguish Fedage from other citizen journalism projects like Grasswire, which I've been a fan of, and I showed that to you briefly. So they're also going to be open source, so that's something that you hope to do as well. And so what do you think will distinguish you from those kinds of projects?
Well, certainly, I've seen a lot of citizen journalism sites. It's actually, I have a sort of a manifesto where I list a lot of these sites. And Grasswire is new. I haven't heard of it and seen it. It's a really great project. I think in order for a sort of a sustainable system of media to emerge where journalists can get paid. I spent about 7 years in Beijing, China, and I worked mostly in advertising, and that would finance some of the independent projects that were more journalism focused. And I had a lot of other friends as well, and we were all, we go and have a drink together, getting Reuters, a lot of freelancers. And it was just an issue of sustainability, like getting paid. How do we make a living? I have a friend in a European press agency who's based in Washington, D.C. He's I've known since China. He's really having a hard time. I know photojournalism, it's just, I'm trying to find a way to get people paid and allow them to have a sustainable living to the, we can have consistent reporting that isn't so. I mean, I'm just reading about the voter suppression in Arizona right now. It's crazy, and I'm not seeing it on mainstream media. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I've only been able to see it on things like Reddit or U.S. Uncut. And I just really have a strong desire to get people paid for their work because it's so good, and when it happens, it's so much better, so much better than what we're seeing in the mass media. That's pretty much my main difference. The other difference would be probably how much it can be wholly integrated with a decentralized structure. I mean, from an engineering standpoint, and I think that involves the content. How we can really have a truly collaborative team to live up to what the internet is intended to be, at least one aspect of it, which is collaborative nature of sharing information. So I'm seeing that happen, and I think it's just a natural effect of the state of technology that exists right now. I don't know if Vettage is going to be sort of the go-to, news resource in the future. The main point is that collaboration, so when I heard about IPFS, I was very interested, especially its basis in blockchain. So I'd like to hear more about that. Actually, I'm also learning. So
yeah. So the fact that you not only want to make it decentralized, but that you also want to have your content producers paid, is going to be really big differences, at least in terms of comparing you to Grasswire, because even though they're open source, Grasswire is entirely centralized, and all of their citizen journalists, none of them are paid. So they're all volunteering their time. So really the only people that can afford to participate in that system is people that can afford to volunteer their time freely. So you're not getting people that you know, maybe don't have as much extra wealth to put on the side that they can afford to do it for free. So that's going to be really big differences if you do that.
Yeah, I just to continue just briefly. I think mostly what I'm saying are you know, whenever somebody has a great idea for a story, they either go to try to use their contacts to hey, do you know the editor for this magazine or this show or whatever, and, or they try to go through grants. Yeah, that's something that I really wanted to fix. Again, I think the blockchain is just a great move forward.
Yeah, and then for the final question that I have, we talked a little bit about how decentralized technology will be really valuable to the future of journalism, and you've talked a little bit about that already, but how do you think overall, like you can mention specifically what you know of Bitcoin or IPFS so far, or just having a decentralized structure in general, how do you think that that will be valuable for journalism? What changes do you think you'll see?
Right, that's, and that actually goes back to the original reason why, another reason, major reason why thought Vantage would help. Any centralized news organization, and that's why I kind of want to stick with Vantage as a software as a service. Really nothing more. An enabler, a tool, a metric point. Any centralized news service is by nature, by the fact that it's limited to the number of people they can have in the field, like staff. The proof is right there. CNN, BBC, all reaching out to people on social media. I have another friend who is a BBC guy. He's in Brussels, and he's asking people on Facebook, hey, were you there? Do you have any video that you shot on your cell phone? And pretty much anybody with this, or any kind of recording device, is, ideally, the one of the main three types of users on Vantage. Because it's impossible for a news organization to be everywhere all the time. And that's why, they're reaching out to, everybody else on the street with a cell phone or any kind of recording device we can bear. Vantage is coming from the other direction. It's I'm incorporating everybody at the same time. So it's not like trying to be, we have this, Pulitzer Prize winning person on our staff, and we have this group, and the office in Paris, and we have another office in Tokyo. It's not like that. It's completely, it's a totally different structure, which, I think that really jives with, the blockchain approach, the decentralized approach to news media. People have to get paid. There's an interesting project on the music industry side with Ethereum, which is, new to me. It's called Udra Music. I think there's a little bit of similarity in the way they've structured, the payment scheme. Like a direct connection between the listener or the person who downloads the music and the actual artist. I'm just, trying to bring together, and I'm focusing on one more thing is the nature of the reporting, the style of reporting that we're seeing merging much, much more online. Instead of just a straight, article text, which is fine, obviously, or just a photo essay, there's a lot of multimedia reporting going on. A lot of websites, news stories are coming out that are showing. I think one of the early ones, and I know there were others before, it's called Snowfall, and it was the first time that I had actually seen really engaging, style of presentation, of a story using multimedia techniques and video and interactive, aspects of the story to really engage your audience. And that's sort of like another criteria of the reporting that we've gone through. So, I mean, there are four criteria by which people can rate the stories. Is it newsworthy? Is it credible? Is it timely? Is it relevant to what's going on right now? And finally, presentation style. I mean, is it engaging? Is it, all the sort of, the technical aspects, and does it flow well in the presentation style? The Society for News Design, SND.org, has a lot of good examples of that, and I think they do great work in fostering, this kind of reporting of awards every year. But that's, hopefully that answers the question.
This is really cool. Okay, I just want to jump in here because I'm finding this really fascinating, and it's an area that I've been looking at for a long time. And I want to start off just by introducing a real world use case of a story that broke back in late February of a school stabbing in Canada. I'm going to bring up the story for you. It was reported widely in the mainstream media, of course, but at the same time, there was citizen journalism. In other words, there were just individuals on Twitter. I particularly noticed a presence on Twitter and on Tumblr, where the girl, the perpetrator, the accused, was very, very frequently posting updates and apparently predicting and telling people that she wanted to stab people. So she was on social media. Now, what I want to talk about here is really the responsibility and the professionalism of journalism, and the difference between a professional journalist who obeys the laws, particularly in Canada. If you're under the age of 16, your name is not allowed to be reported. What is often happening, as I've noticed with these kinds of citizen reports about these kinds of cases, is that they completely don't care. It's not that they know what the law is and they break the law. They just haven't thought about it. They're just people on social media. They're not journalists, not being paid by anybody. And what they start doing is they start trawling the web. And what I found particularly of note, I'll show you one of her social media sites. This is the last post that she made on her DeviantArt page before she went off and did what she did. Now, luckily, nobody died, but people were seriously injured. I think as many as 8 people by the last time I looked at the reports. And it's ongoing. And you can see here that there's pages and pages of people all coming around, because these people knew her and they were friends with her on these social media sites. Tumblr was accused of editing. This is actually on archive.org. This was her Tumblr, and Tumblr staff were going through editing her posts, as it's been alleged, by these citizen journalists. Now, obviously, I'm not going to give her name. That would not be responsible. It would not be in the public's interest. But what I've noticed, Shannon, is that these people just want to know what the truth is. And what was interesting was it wasn't even as if I was finding this on Grasswire or Bellingcat or any of the usual places where you would expect to see this kind of coordinated journalism. I was finding it on bodybuilding forums. I was finding it on autism websites. I was finding it on, weird sort of obscure forums who were sort of weirdly kind of had an interest in it because maybe there was something, they knew her from another place and another site on the web, or just because somebody found it interesting, posted it up. And what happens is everyone then jumps on and says, I want to know more, I want to know more. And so they start fishing up details. And what impressed me the most, and what I want to hear your thoughts on, was just how efficacious Google, Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr especially, were at removing all traces of her name and photographs. It took me, and I'm a really good surfer of the web. I don't use Google. I use Startpage. I use DuckDuckGo. I know all the tools. It took me about 30 to 40 minutes to find her Facebook page. That's actually a long time in internet time. That's like maybe a few weeks in internet time. And I was surprised at how effective Google had been at erasing anything that had her name in it. Articles that were posted that had her name in it contemporaneously as it was being reported had since been edited. Comments in those articles had been removed that then reiterated it or said, oh my God, they're using her name. that's out of line. And then people, and so what you were left with were, in the official mainstream media, were vestiges of comments of people saying, that's out of line, the journalist should never have done that. And then I'm looking at the article going, what has he done? What has he done? And then somebody comes in later saying, oh, he, what they're moaning about is that he used her name. And then he was told to remove it. And this was what this flame was. But all you see is the leftovers. And then you get this alternative web where people, it's just the Wild West. People just do what they want and they say what they want and they're not professional journalists. And now that we're entering into this age of permanence, and we're going to talk about the permanent web in a minute with IPFS, but also Bitcoin is a permanent stateful structure. What are the moral hazards? What does this mean for journalism and ethics in particular? How do we make sure that journalism and people and these stories are reported upon ethically?
That's a great question. And again, you know, like you said, the Wild West. that's the aspect that we're dealing with the internet. I mean, there is no, it's not even the Wild West, it's the wild world. And the fantastic things, you know. I mean, it's really the structure of that is the third sort of user. I mean, you have anybody with a recording device. There's one type of user, completely raw content. It can be text, it can be screenshots, it can be whatever. But the editors are sort of a fulcrum element here between, you know, subscribers and raw content. They're the ones who, it's just a logical, it's just a natural need for someone who, with a technical knowledge of how to arrange all of this, you know, raw content from all over the place, you know, to go into the jungle and, you know, it's all there, but, you know, to take the specific ingredients and then compose them in a particular recipe and present it, you know, to the public, right? So the editors are the ones who are really tasked with that sort of ethical presentation of the story, to, you know, integrate all of that. And again, it's the subscribers who rate that content based on our criteria. So there's no really way to, at least in this particular scheme, that, you know, to really escape that necessity for ethics, necessity for, because it's one of the criteria of how people get paid. You know, if you're not ethical, if you're not credible, you're going to take a hit. How much you get paid. That's how it's.
The problem is that people need to know what the truth is, even if they don't want to know it. People need to know it. So yes. The problem with advertising is that at the moment, what you have is a model where journalists basically write clickbait headlines in order to drive up ad revenue. And it's not always the case. There are plenty of really good journalists out there. But by and large, what you see on the web today with magazines like Wired now that are telling you if you use an ad blocker that you can't view that content and so on, is you're reaching a standoff moment where the press and the industry, journalistic industry, are basically turning around to the consumer and saying, if you can't have this content unless you pay, someone's got to pay. You were always paying before, but what you were paying with is your attention, because we were selling advertising. When that bubble burst, you still need to know the truth. Like, we need to know the truth about the terrorist attacks in Brussels, for example. We need to know the truth about what happened with MH17. We need to know the truth about all these things, because nobody goes into the world wanting to be lied to. I mean, you might do for a while, you might need to be in denial, but I would argue that being in denial is not lying, because to be in denial, you have to know what the truth is in order to deny it to yourself in the first place. Right. So I don't mind, you know, to a certain extent, this confirmation bias, people just reading the Daily Mail because this is what they want to hear, and I understand that. But we've also seen from other studies that have been done that people will actually go out and seek information that they disagree with. And I think there was a study done quite some time ago in Second Life where they had like this mosque, and there were these Jewish people that were using the software who wanted to go into this virtual mosque just so that they could see what it was like. They would never have done this in real life, but they would do it in a virtual environment. And in, I can't remember the name of the study. I will try to dig it out. It was on a podcast. I heard about it on a podcast called Tunnel Vision, which is an excellent podcast if you stick that into DuckDuckGo. And the essence of this study was that people do want to have their beliefs challenged, that when a belief enters your mind, you often defend it regardless of how it got there later on. And the extent to which you will try to disprove things that you thought you once knew and were sure of is really a function of your own ability to self-reflect and to be self-aware. But one of the things that mainstream media has done so well is give people what they want rather than respond to what they need. That people need the truth. And for me, the essence of journalism is verification. Right. It really, as a journalist, you're there to verify in a funny kind of way, in an odd kind of way, not funny as in haha. These unofficial journalists, these guys on the bodybuilding forums and all over these kind of things, they're actually doing journalism because they're verifying things. They're actually going out. They're using alternative search engines. They're finding people. They're finding their Facebooks. They're doing all this kind of stuff. And I think what it leaves us with is a very big responsibility about what we do next. Because at the moment, the web is still impermanent. It's still flaky. You know, you get lots of link rot. Websites go down. It's as we saw with this girl's name not being released. Look at how quick those social networks were to clamp down. And they probably have algorithms, I'm guessing, already looking for the name, and they are instantly things. Last night, I noticed that the hashtag Stop Islam on Twitter was not auto-completing for me, and that when I did get to see Stop Islam, I got all the positive stuff. So all the stuff that was saying this is a stupid hashtag, how the hell did this start, who started this, all of those kinds of tweets. It took me a long time to get to the tweets that were the original Stop Islam tweets that also had a lot of retweets, also got a lot of likes. But the suspicion that I was left with was that Twitter was perhaps massaging some of these search results because politically they've got a liability on their hands if they don't. These social networks now are in a position where they can even sway elections just by showing you a few extra clips of Donald Trump instead of his opponent. And those few extra seconds can mean all the difference in an independent swing vote state. And this leaves us with a huge, huge responsibility. So before we go over to Mose and take a look at this brave new world that we're about to head into and some of the technical stuff, did you have any kind of final thoughts on that? We'll come back to you later. Of course, you can come in and talk to us about it. But I just wondered what your thoughts were on this huge responsibility that we're going to be facing.
Absolutely. I'm really glad you brought that up. There are a lot of tools for verification. I know that it's possible to spoof metadata on an image, for example, on a JPEG taken with a camera, as far as like where it was taken, the time, and so forth. But there are ways around that. I know Berkeley is doing a lot of good research in that area. They have a product that can ObscuraCam, I believe, is the last name I remember of the product. So these tools, and I'm speaking of, are you know, available to the public. I don't know if they're all for free, but they are there to verify, even independently verify, you know, content. There's also something about open source development where, you know, people can verify the code, you know, for something that exists or doesn't. But the fact that those tools exist, that's encouraging. And Zedish has a blog section, you know, that you can link to, or, you know, regular articles from an admin, you know, from the admin side. So really kind of strongly encouraging people to use these tools for verification, because that is one of the main, again, one of the four criteria for the rating system. When subscribers go and rate the articles of the pieces, you know, credibility is one of the main four criteria. So, and how do you establish, oh, this is credible or not? Well, there are the tools, and it's possible. And before the subscribers even get to that point, the editors have to do that. You know, they're encouraged to do it before they release something that's potentially damaging to their reputation, because it's really kind of like on a trust it's not even built on trust, it's just like credibility. You know? So I think you're a great example. You're a great example of someone who's actually, you know, boots on the ground, goes out and finds, you know, goes to these alternative websites and does all this great research to make sure what there's most people, and again, it goes back to another thing you mentioned, human nature. It's a psychological thing. I mean, we can't fix human psychology, you know, on the internet, but we can encourage certain aspects of it. So I think that's hopefully what you meant.
Okay, yeah. So just to summarize then, so you mentioned four things about an article, about something that you're going to publish. It needs to be newsworthy, credible, timely, stroke relevant, and then you need to consider the presentation style itself. And I think what I'm going to do now is I'm going to segue into what Mose is going to show us, some work that he's been doing. But before I do, I just want to show people where this has really come from. So a couple of years ago now, let me pull up my GitHub. I did a project. I believe this was the first time that anyone had ever done a cryptographic decentralized piece of journalism. And it was an investigation on the Bitcoin crypto exchange Moolah. And I did an investigation in which I was running a tracking software on my computer that was monitoring my browsing. And as it was monitoring my browsing, it was taking periodic timestamps of the actual HTML content and the pictures that I was using, and it was doing it contemporaneously. So it was doing it, it was timestamping, I was just running a little script and it was just uploading on the fly at intervals, and then what was happening was it was timestamping it, and then you could see all of the web pages I had been looking at. And obviously this was in a sandboxed environment, so you're not going to accidentally, you know, see something weird that I looked up or something like that. You're just going to see what I happen to be looking at. And what it does is it would take a mirror of the website, it would actually download the whole of the HTML content in case it was removed. So you see here you have the actual HTML page that I was looking at, and then it would download any pictures. And so what you have here is a cryptographic witness. In other words, the cryptography is witnessing me as a witness, witnessing the events as they unfold, if that's not a bit too meta for everyone. So and that's something that gets used, that term witness gets used in cryptography all the time. We have a new feature entering Bitcoin called segregated witness, which uses that same content. A cryptographic hash, like the ones that you're seeing here, are basically pointers or URIs. They point to a resource. They point to something that you have produced, a discrete digital object like a web page or like a photograph. And when you publish that cryptographic digest as a witness, as if the universe were witnessing it, you can then put it into the metadata of something like the Bitcoin blockchain. We choose the Bitcoin blockchain because it has the most computing power behind it, the most hashing power behind it, so it's very, very difficult to censor. It's practically impossible to censor. But also what it means is that it's incredibly difficult for me as a journalist to lie about what I witnessed. Why? Because it's time stamping my witnessing contemporaneous with events. So if I wanted to lie about something, I would have to know ahead of time what I was going to lie about. I would have to manufacture my entire browsing habits. I'd have to have two laptops open, one where I was doing the real browsing and another one where I was faking the browsing entries. It would raise the marginal cost of me doing the investigation. And one of the interesting things that I was able to do with this project, if I go to the evidence bundle, I don't know if I'll be able to find an example because it's been such a long time since I looked at this, but you'll see here, the idea was that you have like a timestamp and then you have, so there was some files that were encrypted because as a journalist, I had a responsibility. I'm not going to be able to find them now because there's just too much content here. Let's take a look at what this is. But essentially what it was if I came across I came across the address of the parents of one of the accused, and obviously it witnessed me seeing this address, and obviously I didn't want that address to be published and then made permanent on the internet. So what I did is I created a PGP key. I encrypted the, I hashed the actual content itself, put the hash outside in the text file, encrypted the content with a PGP key I created, and then I keep the PGP key for myself, but I publish the hash of the raw content. So let's say the address is, you know, number one, I don't know, Sterling Street. What it'll do is it will encrypt that, it will take a hash of that data, kick that up into plain text at the top of the investigation file, not show you the address, but encrypt the address with a specially created PGP key, so that in the event that anyone wants to come along and investigate me and question my integrity as a journalist later, they can do so. I can give them the PGP key, they can decrypt it, they can look at it, they get the cryptographic digest, they compare it to the one that was published, and they can say, oh yes, Chris did do his investigation properly. The address that he found matches, contemporaneous with events, the address that the software saw him witness at the time. And you could have organizations like Amnesty International, right, publish the fact that they have investigated a journalist and vouch for the investigation without that journalist having to reveal their sources, without them having to give away the names and addresses of anyone that's sensitive. So I put forward a Mular investigation. It was just a live hack demonstration of a story that was unfolding, and I was really just trying to demonstrate what is possible. Things are about to hit steroids now with Mosaic, because what you can do since then, we now have something called IPFS, which is the Interplanetary File System, so named because the internet was originally named the Intergalactic Network, the Intergalactic Network of Networks. So they wanted to kind of mirror that kind of ethos. And one of the features of IPFS is, the tagline for it is the permanent web. And what's dangerous about this and what's different to the IPFS than the way I was doing it with Git was that Git was at least to some extent centralized. Like GitHub hosted it and GitHub could have taken it down again unless you'd got a copy ahead of time. But IPFS is decentralized, and that decentralization is baked into its protocol. That's what it is. That's how it operates. So Mosaic, tell us about what you've been doing with the hosting, because you were hosting our videos on BitTorrent, and now you've moved over to IPFS. So why did you choose to do that, and what have you created? What monster have you created for us?
I switched to IPFS mainly because with Torrents, the problem was you can't give out one address for the whole collection. If you add new episodes to the torrents, then you would have to redistribute the hash of the whole collection. But with IPFS, we have this naming mechanism where each IPFS node has an ID, which consists of a public-private key pair, and with this you can publish to this address. And this way you can basically have a single address for the whole collection and still add new episodes without having to distribute a new address for the whole collection.
So what I'm looking at here, for example, this is on your website. The link is in the description below, ipfs.raincloud.ch/IPNS, which is their naming system, their decentralized naming system. How have you found IPNS? I mean, I tried using it. It's been very slow for me. How have you been getting on with it?
Yeah, it has some problems with resolving, especially if you start putting a lot of data into the node.
Okay, so I want to break this down because obviously a lot of people watching this are not necessarily going to be very technical. So if I just expand my window here, what you'll see up in the address bar is very different to what you're used to seeing in an ordinary address bar. Let me just hide some of these and clear up some more space. So you can see here that this address does not look like an ordinary address. And one of the things that really this cryptographic hash here. Now, Mosaic, is this the IPNS link?
Yeah, that's the IPNS link. That's the ID of my gateway node. And I published it to the IP. And I could publish it to the IP because I have the private key for this address.
Now, if I click on one of these shows, it's not going to come up. There's no, at the moment, there isn't a video viewer, a media viewer in the actual browser. It's going to take a little while to resolve because I'm guessing we're peer-to-peer. Okay, so now we're in here is this still, oh, this is still the IPNS, and then what you've done here is you've put in some ASCII and some actual plain text that we can actually look at and make some sense of. Is that right?
Inside the IPNS address points to a single IPFS address.
Okay.
And the IPFS address is a folder. You have this folder objects in IPFS where you basically have a JSON file with a name and a hash for items in the folder. And this way you can build whole folder systems. That's an additional part that I added to have some metadata.
Okay.
The main fascination was to build a self-contained application on IPFS, where you have the front end as well as the data all on IPFS.
Now, one of the... let me just stop screen sharing there for a minute. So one of the problems with BitTorrent was that once you'd uploaded the file, it was permanent and immutable. You couldn't change it later without re-uploading the whole thing. And that's really annoying, because if people start seeding and then you say, oh no, sorry, I made a mistake, everyone has to delete the file and start again and download all over again, which is just a violation of the DRIVE principle in computer engineering. Do not repeat yourself. So we don't want to keep having to create redundant bandwidth. Now, think about it this way. If you're not a super technical person, let me explain what I mean by the do not repeat yourself principle. Let's say you're sharing a flat with someone, and you're really into Taylor Swift, and you're both viewing a really cool, your friend is viewing this really cool video by Taylor Swift, and he says, hey, you should see this, and he pings it to you in Skype, because you know that's what we do these days, we Skype each other in the same room, and then you click on the link and you download it, and now what's happening is you're both drawing bandwidth from YouTube servers, and probably some caching is going on some level with the ISP, but essentially you're both using 10 megabytes of downstream data at the same time. It's really, really redundant. And one of the nice properties of both BitTorrent and also IPFS is it works locally first. So they just make it work at a local level to start with, and then it works at a global level secondarily. So in IPFS, what would happen is your friend would download the awesome Taylor Swift video. He would then send you the link. And then when you started to download it, you would download it from the closest node, hops to live, it's called. So your node would broadcast, okay, who's got this hash? I'm looking for this hash. Has anyone seen it? And there is something called a distributed hash table, DHT, that nodes will be storing, that your node will store. And if it's seen it somewhere, it will direct you to the node that has it. And probably the node you're going to start downloading it from first is going to be the node closest to you geographically, because the person's in the same room as you. And that's how it works.
In that case, you can lose the internet connection when the other person has the video already on his node. You still have it available. You can have a whole separated network from the internet, and the content you have is there, not like with today's connected world, where you always have to have connectivity to view anything, even if you have downloaded it the day before.
Yeah, and so one of the things that you might be familiar with as a layperson who's browsing the web is that your browser has something called a cache. Most people are aware of this, broadly speaking, that when you go to a website for the second or third time, your browser isn't literally having to re-download everything all over again. It's got some of the content, at least in a local storage folder, in a content folder on your computer, which is hidden away from you in a library. The library folder has another folder in Max called application support, which is hidden from you as a user, because apparently you're not, you know, it's too dangerous to give you access to this folder. So Apple hide it from you. I think Microsoft hide it from you as well. They then store all of these files in this cache. And what they do is the second time you go to the website, instead of downloading all of the content again, they simply ping the website to see if any changes have been made. And if they don't suspect any changes have been made, they simply serve up the content from your local computer again. And that's why sometimes when people make changes to websites in real time, you don't always see it straight away, and someone has to tell you F5 or you know, Apple R, or just refresh. You need to like do a hard refresh, like clear out your cache so you don't see anything. And that's one of the reasons why. Now, that's interesting because one of the underlying assumptions there of the engineers that were creating the browser for the first time was that users couldn't really be trusted with a lot of the kind of decision making and the protocols and the way data was distributed across space-time. In other words, that they needed to be pandered to, and we needed this kind of perennial engineering philosophy where we'll kind of make it nice and bubblegum-like and it will look very pretty on the outside and you won't have to worry your pretty little head about it. It'll just work, TM. It just works, TM. And you'll just have this wonderful experience. The problem is, though, that it has a real experience. It has a real problem longer term economically, because YouTube now is forcing adverts on their users. It's breaking, the YouTube website will break down if you try to use an ad blocker. And they're even now putting videos in the actual content itself, just like big broadcasters used to do. So every 10 to 15 minutes, you'll get interrupted with an ad, which you can't switch off. You either have to close the whole video and start again, or you have to watch the ad. So of course, what people are doing is they're turning the volume down and then just switching to a different, you know, tab in the browser and just doing something else until the ad finishes. It's actually worse than it used to be, because in the old days, you used to walk off to the kitchen and go make a cup of tea. And that's because these servers do not pay for themselves, folks. Like, they're not, YouTube aren't just got paying for the servers today. They're paying for all the server costs going all the way back to 2006, because they still haven't finished paying off those debts. The reason they're still alive is because venture capitalists were funding them for free, because apparently people won't view your content unless it's free. But this is called, in business and in law, is called the bait and switch. The bait and switch is where you bait somebody in and you get them in and you say, hey, I built you a nice castle here. Why don't you come and enjoy all the things inside? And then you slam the door behind them and you realize the whole thing was a con, that really you were just enticed into this castle so that they could rip you off. And then you learn the true cost. The problem is that these castles are invisible and porous now that we're on the internet. And in some ways, the invisible walls of Facebook are very incarcerating, because people don't see the walls, so they don't feel trapped, and so they stay there. But actually, when you start getting these infringements into your time, like with the adverts, because if you look at if somebody writes something annoying on Facebook or Twitter, it can go ignored quite easily. But if somebody fucks up a video, people really get angry with you. You know why? Because you stole their time. Video is a temporal phenomena. It extends in time. If you waste so much as 30 seconds of somebody's life with a YouTube video because the sound wasn't good enough, or you said something that was offensive to them, they will let you know in the comments. And we've had that before. So one of these interesting features of IPFS is and I know this gets used a lot, but paradigm shift. It's a paradigm shift in the sense that you are no longer a consumer, passively just downloading from the cloud. I mean, I know people use the internet now just to like swap files from one computer to another. Like they can't even be bothered to get a memory stick and plug it in. They just email themselves the file. They walk over to the other computer and they download the file. Like, I see this all the fucking time. And when I used to work in InfoSec, in information security in the film industry, it did my head in. The amount of times people would email each other really, really top, you know, confidential, you know, photographs of celebrities, sometimes embarrassing ones. They were just like sending these files to each other, like for editing and stuff like that in post-production and marketing. And I'm like, dude, that's an unedited picture of an actor that, you know, if that ever got leaked, the press would have a field day, they would make a fortune in sales, you'd be fired, we'd all be fired. And you're just emailing it to that person over an unsecure, unencrypted, like Hotmail account or something. And they're doing it because it's convenient. Mosey, talk to us about the cryptography of IPFS, because IPFS has encryption baked in by default. So you have a public-private key pair when you set up with IPFS, and then when you send files to someone else, does it get encrypted as standard as it goes across that line?
I think it gets encrypted, but the public-private key pair has, I think, nothing to do with that. It's just
Okay.
So you have the permission to publish something with this ID.
Okay. Yeah.
What I heard, the connectivity should be encrypted, but I haven't looked into that.
Yeah, I mean, what I've heard is that it is encrypted, but that they haven't yet had an audit, so they're not ready to kind of say this is end to end, and we're definitely sure this is hard crypto, yeah. Which is fair enough on their part, on IPFS's part. And so what we can now see is a world where people are not just consumers, but they're also producers. So your computer doesn't just become a receptacle and doesn't just like download content. It also has the ability to upload content. So one of the other features that IPFS has is the verb pinning, to pin. Yeah. And it's a little bit like the like button of Facebook, except unlike a meaningless click of a button on Facebook, this actually comes at a cost to you. Because when you pin content on IPFS, you are going to be using up your hard drive space for that file. So let's say you stumble across this really cool Taylor Swift video, and you like it so much that you choose to pin it. Pinning it is like liking it. But the difference is that your computer is now going to keep a copy in its cache, except you know where the cache is, and you can look at it, and you can see an index of it at any time you like, unlike the cache on your browser at the moment where it's all kind of hidden and it's fuzzy and nobody really knows how long it stays there and stuff like that. It's pinned, and you are now sacrificing your hard drive space, plus you're going to be sacrificing some bandwidth, and these are finite resources. And so now you have a many-to-many paradigm where it's not server client, but more a hybrid model, would you say, Moses? Mm-hmm, so, yeah. Sure, people like you've got servers, you can be a super node, for example, and you can be serving up because you've got lots of bandwidth, but I can also be a smaller node. And that doesn't make me a lesser individual or lesser node on the network. I'm still being productive. It's just that you're scaled and I'm downscaled. But yeah, we both have the ability to serve and receive content.
Yeah, I think for efficiency reason, you need to start at one point. It's easier. I'm thinking about methods to have videos added decentrally, but other than sharing a public-private key pair, I didn't come up with a clean solution yet.
Right.
But I think you just need one big enough site to start, and then the idea would be that people who like special episodes or a specific show start to ping them at their home and start contributing their resources to host the whole content of the archive.
So how this impacts on Vettage, Grasswire, Bellingcat, all of these different ideas is that as a journalist, I now have the ability to report on something and host it for myself, rather than, because what we're looking at now is, in sociology you have this concept called a giant connected component. And a giant connected component is they form in networks, and they tend to be an emergent phenomena, and they're things like Google, they're things like Facebook, where lots and lots of nodes all clump together because people want to be together and they gravitate there. And what that does is it creates a focal point for communities and publics plural, so many publics. So for example, you could be a member of a bodybuilding forum and you could be a member of an autism page on a group on Facebook. And that's perfectly okay because temporally you can cross over between the two. It's not discrete, it's not either or. You're not either a member of the bodybuilding forum or a member of the autism group on Facebook. You can be both and it can cross over. And what you get is something that Pierre Levy coined the term, I believe, called temporal unity. In other words, a kind of virtual space, or sometimes referred to as the third space. And the third space, what people mean by that is a place where you can go, leave, and then rejoin, but still have continuity throughout, even in the times when you were not there. Because, of course, the data is persistent. So whilst you weren't there, you can see what was said. Like in a Slack channel or like in a Skype group chat, you can see the history. Just like on Bitcoin, nodes can join and leave the network at will whilst trusting that the longest proof of work chain, as it says at the end of the abstract in the white paper. This is the same principle, and that creates a temporal unity, a different kind of space, because human beings as animals, like, we don't just occupy the space in the same way that other animals do. We actually use the space. We change the space as we move through it. We decorate it. We ornament it. We build on top of it. We create spaces. Vitruvius said, the first ever architect in Rome, said that when you build a building, the walls actually make the space bigger, because those boundaries and constraints free you up to do things that you wouldn't be able to do if it was just left as an open, barren tundra. Right? How on earth could you conceive of having an orchestra in a desert? You wouldn't. But you could conceive of having an orchestra in a theater, in a palladium. Because now he says the acoustics, to be an architect, you have to understand, he says you have to be interdisciplinary. You have to understand acoustics. You have to understand all kinds of, you know, different affordances, people's different capabilities and so on in terms of climbing steps and so forth. You don't just have to know about the physics of the environment as an engineer. You have to understand human needs and human nature. And it was actually the creation of these domes that gave rise to the polyphonics, right? The kind of music that wasn't just pop music that was played outdoors that had a very simple melody and lyrics, but classical music that would have polyphonic. Of course, what that did is subconsciously taught us that our minds were more powerful than we imagined that they were, that we could actually cope with multiple sounds at multiple times and still sort of appreciate it in its kind of, you know, majesty, in its all its polyphonic spree, as it were, right? Mm-hmm. And so this is the lesson that we've been learning, and that was diametrically opposed to the underlying assumptions of aristocrats and monarchs, because they were based on the assumption that only one person could talk at a time, and that was why you needed a monarch. Another reason Plato said you needed a monarch was because if you disagreed with the monarch, you only had one head to cut off. If everyone was in charge, you'd have to go around cutting off everyone's heads. So yeah. There were other benefits too. But the main assumption at the time was that you wouldn't be able to listen to all these voices if everyone was speaking. You just wouldn't be able to, because there's a certain sequence that people have to take up. So when it comes to journalism, publishing, for me, it's about making sure that the right voices are heard and that those people are able to be surfaced to the top based on the merit of their work, based on the verification that they've done, how truthful they are. And at the moment, I don't think we're getting that from the kind of algorithms that we're getting on Twitter. I think Twitter has a liability. It cannot afford to not intervene, because to not intervene is to intervene. If you are persisting data on your centralized server, on your AWS or your Azure, your Microsoft Azure cloud service, okay, and you're delivering this social network out to people as a service, that data, the racist data, as well as the lolcats, as well as all of it, is domiciled on your territory. You have possession of it. And you are therefore liable for whatever goes on in that territory. So when the police come knocking on your door, you've got no choice. You have to capitulate, because government has the monopoly on violence. And they will hurt you and put you in a cage if you don't comply. The difference with IPFS is that when everyone becomes a server, and let's say I write an article, a really good article on this 14-year-old girl who committed this atrocity in Canada, people will actually choose to pin my content and host the content. And what are the police going to do if I violate the law, hypothetically speaking? And I mention her name because I didn't know that in Canada there was a law that banned the printing of names of underage people. And I print it, and now all of a sudden, all these people have started pinning my article, and even I, as the author, do not have the ability to undo what has been done.
Okay.
This is the scary future that we're heading into.
It could have a few very nasty side effects.
Yeah, and that's what I'm trying to like drive home. Like, as much as I'm an advocate for this, I'm not just going to say like, let's just go rush in and not think about it. If anything, what I've been trying to do for the last 2 years of my life is to not rush into this unthinkingly. Like, we definitely need to be conscientious and thinking about this, because there are techniques, to Shannon's point earlier about the verification, I raised an idea a couple of years ago. I was trying to find the link for it. I can't find it at the moment. But basically, cameras could be fitted with their own timestamping functions internally. Oh, so when you're pointing the camera, it's actually displaying the latest Merkle root of the blockchain. You can do this. I used to work in film and media, so I used to do post-production. And one of the things that you can do is you can put – so let's say you've got the camera here. The CCD chip, the sensitive part is here. Lens is here. Scene's over here. Your subject objects are over here. So what's happening is what you can do is you can actually print in digital on LED fashion the latest Merkle root of the Bitcoin blockchain, which is unanticipatable. You can't know it ahead of time. And once you do know it, you've demonstrated that you existed at that time and no time prior, right? Because you can't have known it beforehand. It wasn't unknowable beforehand. It's not only random in the sense that the computation of the miner, it's also random because of the Poisson efficiency, because of all the economic activity that went into producing those hashes that ended up in that Merkle root, right? So it's really fucking random, this number, okay? So what you do is you have this number on an LCD chip, you project it back to front into a mirror, and then what happens is the camera will then take a picture not only of the scenery and the objects and all the events that are unfolding, perhaps some, let's say, some police brutality, but at the same time, it's also got this imprint that's physically being shone back into the CCD chip on the camera of the latest Merkle root. Now, as a post-production artist, I can tell you, this is quite a difficult thing to edit and change, particularly now if you are timestamping that video at intervals. If you're chunking that MP4 file and you're chunking it into, say, I don't know, 1 megabyte blocks, and then you're timestamping those blocks and you're uploading those, I've only got, 30 seconds to edit that video and change its content? I haven't got time. I'm not good enough as an editor to edit on the fly. So now what you've got a situation is where, like, one of the jokes of the Ferguson protests was that, you know, that cartoon, did you see that cartoon of the police pointing the gun at the victim and he's saying, don't shoot me, and then the police officer's looking over his shoulder at the journalist with a camera saying, don't shoot me. So, like, the police officer, the last thing the police officer wants is to be shot by the camera as he's shooting a victim. And that makes them think twice as authorities, is it forces them to question. Like, we even had it ourselves at the Hong Kong protests. Our own reporter, James Bang, went out, and he was kind of threatened down. He was walking down this alleyway, and he had the police officer come up to him, who was being rather intimidating and asking why he was there and what he was doing. He got his camera out, and he said, "You are live on YouTube right now." And this police officer, it's up on his own channel. I'll pick a link of somebody in the chat, if you could find it for us, please link it. It's somewhere on James's website. But yeah, he did this, and this guy just totally froze. He's like, oh, no, it's fine. Because he thought it was live. He thought he was going out live. He thought that, look, even if I confiscate the camera, it's too late. It's already uploaded. The whole internet has just witnessed me, like, doing this, you know, really bad thing. And it's really scary. So it has some really interesting ethical implications, not meta-ethical, but normative ethics. Like, what do we do? Like, meta-ethics is this way, you know, you sit in a nice warm room and you think about what you would do. Like, oh, there's a train coming down the track and you've got five people on the train and there's somebody tied to the rails, and if you could pull a lever, what would you do? Would you sacrifice the one to save the many? This is just hypothetical. Anyone can answer that question. It's easy. When we're doing normative ethics, we're asking ourselves, what are you going to do when the time comes? What do? Do you pull out the camera? Do you start streaming? Do you timestamp it? Do you make it permanent? Because as somebody mentioned to us when we were discussing this, what if somebody ran across the scene naked or something and you had no control over that, and then suddenly that... You can't take it back. You can't take it back. Mm-hmm. I don't know what this is going to do. I want to hear from Shannon again. Sorry, I've been overloading this conversation. So you've been hearing all of this, and what is your technical, at the moment, your technical capabilities? How much of this have you understood, and how, you know, can we make this easier if we haven't?
Yeah, I'm not a technical guy. I'm coming from a journalism background, media background, and I know some programming, HTML, I built the site, based on a template. I hired some guys in India to build the PHP, up to what it is now. It's about 90%, but I still don't have the wherewithal to even, not hugely, but, I have been following the blockchain. I have been following, learning about things, and it's really fascinating. And I do understand to a degree, the implications of IPFS and, just on the decentralization level, the implications ethically for journalism. There's a lot of discussion that people can have. ultimately, it comes down to, what that person chooses to do individually on their own, in any given situation. I can say, for myself, if I'm in that situation where I'm recording, someone naked might run across the screen, I don't have any control over it. Well, so be it. That's not what journalism is not necessarily for, at least in that situation. It's not necessarily to, to censor anything. But worry about that later. If people understand what they're getting into when they click, okay, I want to watch this streaming, then they know that, anything can happen. That's live television, really, live streaming. That's the nature of it. So, there's the understanding too. There are a lot of sides to it to consider. I think there's no direction to go but forward, really.
One of the differences between the kind of data structures that we had before and the kind of data structures we have now is that before we could erase things that happened in the past, whereas now the only way of changing the state of the environment is by adding to it. So it's what's called an append-only data structure. Now, IPFS does allow for deleting, but it's difficult once that data becomes distributed, because now you've got to go around every single person's house and ask them to delete it.
Yeah, that's something that I think is, I have this long concern, I mean, 1984, a long time ago, this thing called the memory hole, and I've always worried, Google gonna start enacting some sort of memory hole, and that's what's happening. I've seen, even without the internet, I've seen stories get pulled or, things get switched around, and so I also really have to applaud going forward responsibly. There are a lot of, in Silicon Valley, I have a friend and some other friends who were involved in a lot of these startups. There's an element of responsibility. People have to take ethical responsibility for their inventions, for their creations. So they don't get out of hand and start creating a lot of problems down the road. And that's a problem. There's no legal recourse really for people to enforce it. There's not necessarily legislation in place that forces. It's called, the best we can hope for is this thing called corporate responsibility. I think the decentralization is just, it's a step in the right direction. When you don't have to depend on corporate responsibility for ethics in an industry. And so when it comes to journalism, so important, something so important as the media, which is the first thing that any dictator will clamp down on, throughout history, all the more. So that's pretty much my take on it. Technically, as I said, I'm still learning. And I'd love to bring all of this together. And they're basically two directions for Vettage at the moment. One is a kind of a business sort of investor-friendly version, which is not on the blockchain. It's just using third payment party processor like PayPal to create I think there's a system that allows for something similar to like smart contracts from the world that I know about smart contracts. And that still has a long way to go. And then the other version is more in the constant area of development. So an open source blockchain based, built from that perspective coming in. So I think that's the way to go. Right now, I think the initial version of Edge would be will not, you know, be blockchain based, but it'll be, you know, like PayPal, just because it's user friendly. Most people, it's hard to get people's head around blockchain. You know, the version I had was originally just exclusively Bitcoin, but I realized that it's hard to get a large enough audience of people involved, you know, if it's exclusively on Bitcoin. So all I'm doing is just expanding the options so more people can use it. And then later, as things begin to take over and people start, you know, more people start to get it, you know, the decentralization aspect and the fairness aspect and the ethics that come with that, then I think, you know, eventually it'll migrate exclusively to, and hopefully, I don't know how far in the future, but it's the blockchain.
Do you think that we need a new code of ethics for journalism, that we need to reassess where we've come from? Because I've looked up numerous ethical guidelines on journalism from all different institutions, including the National Union of Journalists here in the UK, and there's some other projects worldwide, but none of them seem to have a kind of a clear mandate or a clear sort of manifesto on what those ethics should be in given the modern context. Is that something that you think you can deliver and you can give us some insight on, and maybe, as you say, bring people together to collaborate on?
Absolutely. Again, a collaborative process. The code of ethics that does exist now, it always needs to be updated. Every time a new technology comes into play, you know, there's new legislation in Congress or there's new discussions going on. Because there are always implications every time, you know, technological advancement occurs in society. So yes, definitely, they need to be updated. And I think I don't think because we're talking about something that is innate to human nature. So I don't think, you know, ethics is something technically enforceable. Really, ultimately. It's kind of too bad, though, because when someone violates them, you know, we only see it after the fact. So the best we can hope for is to, you know, just try to encourage people to act accordingly. You know, I think, you know, just there are a lot of questions that come up, and, you know, ethical dilemmas. I mean, that's like the stuff of Hollywood films. You know, like the example you gave in the train, just filming or not. It's a personal choice, and the way technology is, I think, you know, the internet or interactive technology has a ways to go, you know, before it reaches a maturation point as opposed to saturation point.
Yeah.
So, okay. So we're on a good track.
What I'm hearing here then, okay, so what I'm hearing is that if the technology outpaces us as a civilization, then we're at risk of being at the mercy of the machine. And by that, I don't mean that, like, in a Skynet type of way, Cyberdyne systems taking over. I mean, we become the machines. We become robotic in our functionality. We become predictable. We become manipulatable by somebody that owns it. Because remember that the word artificial contains the word art. And it contains it for a reason. The word art in the Greek was techne. It didn't just mean to be creative. It also meant to work or craft. So art is really about craft plus your creativity. And when we're creating these tools, if we create them too quickly without really thinking about the consequences, we end up running into them head first and getting into trouble really, really, really quickly. So what I'm hearing from you is that, as well as a technological approach to this, we also need a social response to this too. And that could be in the form of ostracism. That could be in the form, you know, just in this, think of all the self-censorship that goes on. When people talk about the dark web, booger, booger, think about all the nasty stuff on 4chan that people opt out of looking at. Millions and millions. In fact, most of internet users don't look at that kind of stuff, even though it's there. They could see it if they wanted to. They just choose not to. They choose instead to exist inside of their own little bubbles. I ended up finding As you were speaking, Shannon, I was looking around. I'll share this in the link. It's been taken down now, but I found it in the Wayback Machine. And this was on journalism.org, and it had the, you know, the principles of journalism. Journalism's first obligation is to the truth. Its second obligation is to its citizens. And the essence is a discipline of verification. I think that must have been where I was getting it from when I said that earlier. Its practitioners must maintain an independence from those that they cover. They must serve as independent monitor of power. It must provide a forum for public criticism and compromise. It must strive to make the significant, interesting, and relevant. I like that one. It must keep the news comprehensive and proportional. Its practitioners must be allowed to exercise their personal conscience. And of course, there's not much in there about advertising and whether or not you're allowed to plug a particular brand and have that be masqueraded as editorial when it's advertorial. All of these types of aggravating things that we see in modern day. But I think I always felt like that really captured it for me. Like when I read that article for the first time, I was like, yeah, these are some pretty solid principles and some pillars. And as a technologist, and with Mose as well, I think we just need to be very mindful as engineers, and particularly like with me where I'm advocating and I've got, you know, a large following and so forth, I do appreciate the responsibility that comes with that, that I don't want to be advocating that people start going on witch hunts, that they start naming and shaming, you know, people before they've even had access to a fair trial and so forth. So I will put a link to that below. I also want to thank Mose so much for your ongoing work and support. You must be spending a fortune on like resources, like uploading all this stuff. So just in summary, because we did sort of rush through it quite fast, what Mose has done is he has just lost the link. He has uploaded, is it all of the World Crypto Network episodes or some of them? Or
I think it's up to IPFS. IPFS hit the wall at 150 gigs. Okay. Then I start getting trouble with a single node. Now I'm thinking about spreading it across multiple instances.
Okay.
But there I'm at the moment.
That's great. And if anyone had some spare bandwidth, I guess they could pin some of this content,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
And so, yeah, so this is it.
I will probably add as next feature in the web front end. I did build a web front end to make it better viewable, a feature to pin by click, so you don't have to go to the command line and do the stuff. Maybe you can go two directories up and go into the app folder.
Okay, let me just try that now. I'm also, I've got a full node here and I'm just starting up IPFS on the full node so I can show people what that looks like. And then up again. Okay, so there. So that's the root directory.
I think one more.
Okay, one more.
And here the app.
Okay.
It's basically a simple JavaScript HTML.
Oh, okay, great. Wow, it's better than I thought it was. I didn't even see this. Oh my God, it was good enough before, and now it's like even better. Dude, this is incredible. Thank you so much for doing this. This is fantastic work. Okay, well, I'm going to really have a lot of fun doing this. I've been a bit ill recently, so I've been a bit out of it, but I'm starting to get back into it now, so I'm definitely going to be taking a look at this. This looks really awesome. I thank you so much, man. You must have spent a lot of time doing this. Really.
Actually, three weekends coding.
3 weekends? Yeah, that's too much. That's too much.
But I'm fairly new to Node.js.
Node.js. Yeah. I just want to show everyone at home and you as well, obviously, what the full node is. This is, you're not getting this as part of the full node. This is my 5-inch screen that I used, and you can see that IPFS is running there, probably not focusing very well because probably too close, but I use this screen just for testing and stuff because it means I can, you know, get the nodes up and running really quickly without having to attach them to big monitors. And because I'm mobile and I haven't got a fixed address at the moment, I'm having to move around, so it's just a lot easier this way. But you can get these monitors as well, and what I'm going to do with the new software that I release in the latest batch is I'm going to put the drivers for both this screen, which is made by Tontec, and this screen, which is also made by Tontec. Tontec also make the other case, So I'm staying pretty loyal to the brand. I'm using a lot of their hardware just because I think they're really good and they're reliable. And so you can run IPFS with a user interface on the full node. I also, just before we wrap up, we're going to go to Janine before we sign off as well and say thank you to everyone. I also wanted to show you some of the stuff that we're working on. If you've been following me recently, you'll know that I have a boat or that I'm sharing a boat with somebody. And one of the things that we're doing is we're using solar panels. So this is an Anker solar panel. I'm not being paid by Anker to show you this. I've only got it today, so I'm not even suggesting you buy it. But I just briefly tested it outside as the sun was going down, and it seemed to be providing some power even in low light conditions. So this is a solar panel. It's 21 watts. It's the same manufacturer who make the cables that I've been giving out, those really good quality chunky USB cables that I've been giving out with the full nodes. Again, it's not a recommendation, not an endorsement. I haven't tested it yet, but it was one of the ones that was coming up a lot in the reviews that I was looking for when I was looking for a portable solar panel. It's very light. You can just drape it over your backpack, or like, you know, obviously just put it on a place that's viewing the sun, and then you can power a battery, which you can then, from the battery, you can power the Raspberry Pi. And obviously you will need to accumulate some power first. You'll have to front load the battery, but once the battery has got some juice in it, it will happily run the Pi, and then the solar panels will then trickle charge the battery. You might find that you run out of power eventually because there won't be enough sunlight, but that's just going to be something I'm going to be testing out over the summer here in London. And if I get to go back to Africa again, you bet this is going to be in my back, you know, my rucksack when I go over there, because we're going to get lots and lots of sunlight. And that's going to be a great way, because, you know, one of the issues that we came across with Alakanani was that in Botswana they get power outages all the time. But if they've got solar, she doesn't have to worry about that. And if she's on IPFS, she doesn't have to worry about the internet going down, because everyone's got all the content locally. See where this is going? This is powerful stuff, right? And I've been playing around also with some affordable Wi-Fi equipment, stuff like this. It's a little Wi-Fi router, an extender. It's got quite a big range. It's quite affordable. I've just been trying to like buy some of these sort of cheap equipment. Some of you that donated towards the pledge nodes gave me permission, particularly if you're at Stake Pool, thank you very much for watching my shows and thank you for supporting me. Some people gave me permission to spend some of the pledge money on R&D, because we basically are at the moment in a situation where we don't have enough people to send the pledge nodes out to. That's going to be an ongoing process. So what I'm doing is I'm inviting people from countries that are not well represented on the Bitcoin full node map, and I'm trying to get them into the World Crypto Network Slack channel. If you want to be a part of that, you can either find me on Twitter at Mr. Chris Ellis in the address here below me, or you can reach us at fullnode@protip.is. That's fullnode@protip.is. And if you're from a country like Mexico, Indonesia, Botswana, Sierra Leone, any of these countries that are not well represented in this distributed movement, we will want to get to know you. You can come into the Slack channel, we can chat. And what we're really looking for is just somebody that's going to be a good steward of the full node. We're looking for somebody that's going to look after it, it's going to keep it online. You can always count on us to give you tech support as and when. We've got, you know, Ollie, obviously, he's a bit of a little genius. He's in the Slack channel pretty much all day, every day. We've also got Steve, my very own. You've got me, and you've got Mose and anybody else that might be able to help you with your technical problems. So at the moment, we're in a situation where we have more pledge nodes than we have people to pledge to. But I'm working on that, and in the meantime, I am buying some of these low-cost gadgets and equipment to see what we can do and how we can be creative in these areas. Because what I think, you know, along with Shannon's work at Vettage, is we can create these kind of mesh networks where people can basically get together, self-organize, and create their own fourth estate. Or is it fifth estate, Janine? I don't even know anymore. Is it fourth estate or fifth estate?
Journalism as a whole, it's part of the fourth estate, but then the term fifth estate came up with things like WikiLeaks, where they keep right. The fourth estate accountable. Yeah.
Right. So, yeah, okay, well, that's it. I mean, that in closing then, I love what you're doing, Shannon. I think you're in the Slack channel for the World Crypto Network, so we're going to be able to stay in touch. We're going to be able to help you, I think, to some degree, technically. I don't know quite what your ambitions are yet, but as we get to know those, even if we don't have the ability to do it, we certainly will know someone who does. And we can put you in touch with them, but it all sounds pretty good. My advice to you would be just do it, like just like I did with the Moolah thing, just do something, and even if it's just a demo, just try it out, show it to people and say, hey, look, I just did this thing, what do you think?
Absolutely, yeah, that's pretty much what I've been doing. You know, as much free time as I can muster, that's how it worked, and that's why I'm also really want to thank you guys for having me on. It's a really interesting community. I have a few other projects sort of pulling at me, but they're all equally engaging. This is kind of like really interesting because I don't know where it's going to go. I have an idea, but I'm very interested, and I'd like to learn more. So definitely, technically.
I would go so far as to say I've only known you for an hour and a half, but I can tell you you're probably one of the most important people in this movement. And the reason is because at the moment there are too many engineers who consider themselves apolitical, and they consider themselves amoral in a sense that, like, they don't feel like it's their job to be looking at the ethics. Like, my job is to code. And the problem with that is you end up with what's known as Machiavellian efficacy. Machiavelli came up with this idea of fortuna and efficacy. Basically what it means is you're just really, really good. But just being really, really good, or being really intelligent, or being really smart doesn't make you a good person. You could be really, really efficacious at killing people, and you would be very talented at it, but it would be a terrible disaster. So we need more people like you, Shannon. We need more people that are capable of thinking at the level that you are, so that you can direct the engineers, so that they don't sleepwalk us into, some kind of nightmare scenario where, content can be uploaded and never deleted, and then people start fighting each other because they can't forget and they can't forgive. These are the kind of issues. I don't have the answers, but like you say, if we can bring people together into a forum which is conducive to this kind of discourse without falling out, hopefully, and keep it critical and productive, then I think we have something very special on the horizon. So, yeah, thanks very much for joining us today. It was a pleasure to have you. And Mose, likewise, are we going to any more updates on the horizon? What are you working on next?
Yeah, the pinning. To make the pinning into the GUI so that non-command line user could start their own node in episodes.
And do you have a GitHub for this? Do you have a Git repo?
Yes, mosi/wcn-ipfs-archive, I think.
Okay, let me get that up right now. I've just found it, so people won't have to. So there it is. That's it. I'll put this in the description as well, and you can go ahead and look at that and build your own if you want to, if you've got your own YouTube channel. Now that YouTube is starting to put adverts in content, it's getting increasingly difficult to strip the videos off the YouTube website, which means that if YouTube just decide that they don't like your views, they can just delete your video, and even you can't get access to your own content, and that's pretty awful. And
so it should work for all YouTube channels, and I plan to publish as well the method with which I fetch the videos, so anyone could use it.
Okay, that's great. And so now, Janine, you said you wanted to discuss something briefly. Asha, I'm going to pull up the screen grab here. What's the story?
Yeah. I just wanted to give a shout out to her because she also does. She's the founder of Crypto Party, and she does freelance work herself, and I just she's made like a lot of really good comments about how freelancers need to be given more support, and that a lot of their work, they end up working for free for these big media corporations that they either, like Shannon said, that they can't actually get their reporters on the ground. They end up asking these citizen journalists, and then the citizen journalists either don't get credit or they don't get paid. So I just really like this comment that she made, that a salaried journalist fabricating quotes is an affront to every unpaid hour freelancers put in reporting news and still report honestly. because that also brings in the ethics we were talking about, that not only are you not paying them, but you're being paid to make up these quotes. Like even The Intercept, which I've been quoting in my Apple versus FBI story, they've had a problem recently where they had to get rid of a journalist because he was covering, I think, the Ferguson protests, and he was making up quotes about that. So I just really like this comment. She's been making a lot of those comments recently, so I thought they were really good. And then in regards, I just wanted to make a comment about in terms of building or writing a new ethics system for journalism, is that I usually like what the institutions put out, like those rules I've seen before. The one thing that I don't like about it, though, is that it's the point about that journalists should be accountable to citizens. And I think that the word citizen either should be changed or clarified, because that will probably be confusing, because like, citizens of what country? Do you mean all citizens? Because if you're including all citizens, that's like everyone. Everyone is, like, there's very few people that are, you know, not citizens of some country. So who exactly are you talking about? Are you favoring specific countries? So you have to, like, you would have to strike a balance between, you know, if you're a journalist in one country, are you writing only articles or giving out content that is favorable to the citizens that are in your country, or like, how is that going to play into how well you tell the truth? Or you get the opposite situation where you have media organizations in countries where they're not accountable to the citizens of that country, they're accountable to more powerful countries. So.
And I think that would be especially relevant in the refugee crisis that's currently taking place into Europe from Syria, because these people are stateless and they're not citizens of anywhere anymore. I mean, particularly the Pakistanis that are currently in Turkey and trying to get into Europe, they threw away their passports. They can't even get back into Pakistan anymore, right? So they are now stateless people. And so what is the duty of the journalist? You're quite right. Obviously, that particular principle in those guidelines came from a statist paradigm. And so now that we have a global society of states, which has always existed, I mean, it's always been anarchy for the rich and powerful, right? The king's always had access to anarchy because there's no 911 on the world stage, right? There were no rulers on the world stage. You always had to, like, get together and think about things. But if you were a subject of one of these countries, then you were living in a statist paradigm, so you had to live under the guise of a government, and apparently they had to, like, do everything for you, provide all the services and so on. And so as we come out of that, just in the same way we came out of slavery, some might argue we're coming out of statism. Who will pick the cotton? Who will build the roads? Kind of sounds very similar, doesn't it? We might well see a world where the state, certainly if not disappears, but becomes much weaker and vestigial in its process. We might end up looking at the Mexican border and it'll turn into a tourist attraction, and people will turn up just like they do to the Berlin Wall. You turn up to the in Berlin and they've got bits of the wall, you know, in ornaments, and they're saying, look, there was once this border here. And people might be doing the same thing in Israel and Palestine and places like the Mexican border with the US, and saying, oh, isn't it funny how quaint how people used to, you know, enforce these borders in such a futile fashion. But maybe that day will come, I don't know. But so thank you, Charlene, very much to you too, because you've produced the show. It wouldn't be possible without you. You did all the preparation, you did all the organization, you did all the questions at the beginning, and then I stole it from you. Sorry.
And yeah, it's okay. Thank you, because, you know, I asked these guys beforehand if they were okay coming on the show, because I thought it would be a good follow-up to what we did before, and I'm really glad that Shannon contacted me about this. I'm really excited about what we can help him with Vetage. So.
Yeah, no, me too, definitely. Yeah, so thanks very much for your production and everything, and thank you to Shannon, and thank you to Mose for all your hard work. Thank you, too, at home for watching this. If it weren't for you, there would be no point in making these videos in the first place. So you deserve some gratitude, and you will have it. So you can follow us on Twitter at WorldCryptoNet, worldcryptonetwork.com. com, and you can follow me at Mr. Chris Ellis, and the links to everyone in the show are in the description below. Subscribe, 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 like, share, tell everyone about it. See you next time. Bye-bye.